much for spending part of your Saturday evening with us. We've got some brand new music, some slightly new music for you, but tonight's program is really a family affair in the sense of the CMU community of composers on display here. So we're starting with a world premiere, and in particular, a piece called Strung Out on Strings, an homage to Balada, composed by Dr. Christopher Capizzi. Dr. Capizzi currently teaches jazz piano and improvisation for the CMU School of Music, as well as the CMU Music Preparatory School and pre-college music programs. In addition to his teaching, Dr. Capizzi is a professional jazz pianist, composer, and conductor. He earned multiple degrees here at CMU in the School of Music, where he studied for some time with Leonardo Balada, and he received his PhD from the University of Pittsburgh. I'd like to invite Chris up for a moment to just tell you a little bit about how this piece came to be and the connection with Leonardo Balada. Christopher.
Thank you. The piece you are about to hear is dedicated to my esteemed former teacher, colleague, and friend, Leonardo Balada, on the occasion of his retirement from the Carnegie Mellon School of Music. He and I go back a long way. And looking back, the warm relationship we have today developed throughout two distinct periods. Initially during my time as his undergraduate composition student in the late 1980s, and second, as professional colleagues following my return to the school in 2004 as an artist lecturer in jazz and improvisation. His lifelong dedication to the avant-garde continues to be an inspiration to me, as well as his countless former students and professional composers all over the world. I know he's watching the live stream presentation tonight, so I hope he will accept this tribute as a commemoration of my appreciation and of my affection. Lastly, I'm so grateful to the Contemporary Ensemble for this opportunity and to the quartet for their excellent work, but especially to Maestro Curtis, whose idea was to present my homage alongside one of Balada's own works, Caprichos number 7. Thank you.
Thank you.
yet set for our second piece. I'm going to say a little bit more about Leonardo Balada. I know you don't have too much information in your programs about the composers, and it occurs to me there may be some people among us who don't necessarily know who Leonardo is and his legacy here at CMU. So I'll give you the highlights of a very, very rich life. Balada was born in Barcelona, Spain on September 11th, 1933. And after graduating from the Barcelona Conservatory, he made the trip to New York to study at Juilliard. There he studied with Vincent Persichetti and Aaron Copland. He also studied conducting with Igor Markevich. And in the 1960s, Balada developed his highly personal avant-garde and aleatoric techniques that Christopher was speaking of and which inspired Christopher's own use of those techniques. And these would become calling cards for Balada's style. Later in the 1970s, he was credited as a pioneer in blending the avant-garde and the folkloric idea, mixing the old and the new. This is a very important concept in all of Balada's music. And in Balada's music, one finds a somewhat perplexing combination of traditional Spanish culture coming head to head with modernity and avant-garde. And it's important to note he considered Salvador Dali, a close friend and collaborator on multiple occasions. And Balada said that the idea of a surrealist collage was in many ways the closest version of what he was doing in his own scores in creating modernist surrealist collage. Much of his music also embraces a certain plasticity, like it can be molded, and also a theatricality, often juxtaposing stark contrasts in a rather blunt way for maximum effect. Another defining element of Balada's works throughout his career has been an interest in controversial subjects. He does not shy away from them, he leans into them. With anti-war pieces such as Guernica, works about social justice, such as his homage to Martin Luther King's symphony, and even works about environmental concerns in his later years. Balada composed 7 complete operas, 6 large-scale symphonies, among many other large pieces, which have been performed or premiered by the Pittsburgh Symphony, the New York Philharmonic, the Philadelphia Orchestra, the Cincinnati Symphony, Los Angeles Philharmonic, Rochester Phil, Brooklyn Phil, the list goes on. Practically every major orchestra in the United States and many throughout Europe have played his music. Musicians who have commissioned or premiered works by Balada include Alicia de la Rocha, Andres Segovia, Montserrat Cabal, Jose Carreras, Andres Cardenas, and Julius Baker. Since 1970, Leonardo and his wife Joan have lived right here in Pittsburgh. And until just last year, but beginning in 1970, Leonardo was the distinguished professor of composition for the School of Music for 5 decades. The number of students that he taught is truly astounding over that time. And the magnitude of his influence on a younger generation of composers is about as great as any teacher of composition that I can think of. And this evening, as we prepare to perform Caprichos number 7 for you, and as Christopher mentioned, we wish to honor Leonardo and in the moment of his retirement, which actually occurred last year, but we were all online somewhere. Right, and we weren't here together to honor him and celebrate. So I hope that this is in part doing just that. Around 2001, after Balada wrote his operas and his symphonies. He started writing much smaller music, chamber pieces, and he came up with this title, Caprichos, which was untethered to any tradition, and he liked that, the idea that he was free to create this new form of caprichos, which could adapt to whatever chamber ensemble of instruments he wished to write for at the time. Between 2003 and 2005, he would write 13 different caprichos, each for different combinations of instruments, often involving one soloist amongst other instruments. So Capriccio number 7 is that exactly. We have a solo clarinet amongst the ensemble here. And Capriccio number 7 is also a standout because it directly takes on Spanish folk music as a source material in the form of a popular Spanish tune called La Tarera, which don't go looking for it in when you listen to the piece. It's used in an abstract way as the source material for this piece. Balada said about Capriccio number 7 that it's like a serialist canvas in which the material is transformed in a to-ing and fro-ing from abstract to ethnic, from atonal to modal, and vice versa. And that I think you do hear very concretely in the music, moving from atonal to modal to folk material to avant-garde. And finally, a few words about our performers tonight. First and foremost, our soloist, Zachary Neville, a clarinet AMS student currently studying with Professor Tommy Thompson here in the School of Music. Zach and I go way back because during his master's years, Zach was my graduate assistant and worked very closely with the Contemporary Ensemble for 3 seasons of projects and concerts, including a big project around Leonardo's Steel Symphony, which we rearranged for a chamber ensemble. And so I'm really thrilled at this full circle moment to now be featuring Zach at the end of his educational journey here at CMU as a soloist in front of the ensemble that he's worked with and for so many years. I'm grateful to Zach for your enthusiasm and your passion on this piece and this project throughout. And finally, joining the ensemble tonight is actually a special guest. Seated at the piano tonight is Brian Gilling. Although he looks young enough to be a student, he's not. He is a professional musician and a frequent collaborator of mine over the years. And as happens sometimes in performance of contemporary music, I found myself in the unfortunate position 36 hours ago needing to find a replacement pianist for Balada's Caprichos. And I'm very grateful that on 36 hours notice, Brian agreed to jump in and play the piece with us today. So thank you to the whole ensemble, and after we tune, this will be Caprichos number 7.
Thank you.
Toru Takemitsu once said that, quote, "My music is composed as if fragments were thrown together unstructured, as in dreams. You go to a far place and suddenly find yourself back home without having noticed the return." So arguably the most famous Japanese composer of the 20th century, Takemitsu was largely self-taught. I found that very interesting. He taught himself to compose and then sought out the likes of Messiaen to be his compositional mentors. And initially, when he started composing, he was using the Western European avant-garde techniques, not too dissimilar from those used by Leonardo Balada. And interestingly, for most of his life, Takemitsu resisted engaging at all with traditional classical Japanese music of any kind. For him, traditional Japanese music had become tied to war, the war of his childhood in the 30s and 40s, growing up in Tokyo. So the traditional Japanese music was not something he wanted to engage with at all. And ironically, it was through Claude Debussy's music, a French composer whose fantasies about Japanese culture were very important in the French composer's work. It was through Debussy that Takemitsu actually reconciled this competing forces between the avant-garde and traditional Japanese music. So Takemitsu frequently described the experience of listening to his music as being somewhat like strolling through a Japanese garden. There's lots of nature influence in what he writes. But in the 1970s, he came into his late style, and actually a different environmental imagery became even more prominent than the garden, which is that of water, and more specifically, rain. In the 1980s, Takemitsu composed a series of rain-themed works titled Rain Tree, Rain Coming, River Run, I Hear the Water Dreaming, and Rain Spell, the piece you're about to hear. Although you do hear musical splashes and dips and trickles and all sorts of watery types of sounds, the connection with rain and water also operates on a philosophical level for Takemitsu. For him, rain evokes an awareness of transience, saying that it was his intention through this series of works to create, like their subject, to have them pass through various metamorphoses culminating in a sea of tonality. I love that idea that he coined, the sea of tonality. Rain Spell is an especially interesting work to me from Takemitsu's late period, because you can really hear him engaging with this dichotomy of traditional Japanese sounds versus avant-garde techniques. At this stage in his career, he had reconciled the difference and was willing to engage in that. And so I want to point out in this piece, this quintet of instruments you see before you, Alice, our harp player, has been asked to detune five of her strings, or I should say retune five of her strings, to lower them by a quarter tone. And this, combined with non-traditional plucking and strumming techniques, gives an impression of a Japanese koto instrument. And in a similar way, the extended techniques you'll hear from the flute, alto flute, and clarinet, the wind players in this piece, play a lot of multiphonics and timbral trills, which in their own way give us a sense of instruments like the Japanese shakuhachi. So in a similar but different way from Balada, we have the new and old mixing and coming head to head in this beautiful piece of music. Hope you enjoy Rain Coming.
Thank you.
going to take us about 2 minutes just to reset for our last piece, so feel free to take a stretch in our short break here before the last piece. Thank you. longer than expected. Thank you for waiting. As the ensemble gets settled, as we get our setup perfected here, I want to introduce you to the composer of the last piece on tonight's program. Annie Hsieh was born in Taiwan and raised in New Zealand and Australia. And Annie's compositional interests focus on creating music as an immersive physical experience. And she prefers to describe her music in terms of choreography, effective aptitude, and resonances in spatial constraints. Annie received her doctorate degree from the University of California, San Diego, working with Lei Liang and Katarina Rosenberger. Annie's current research delves into embodied physicality in performance through technological augmentation. And I was very happy when Annie joined our faculty a couple of years ago as assistant teaching professor in the Carnegie Mellon University School of Music, where she teaches classes in contemporary music analysis and music theory. Annie is also one of the co-directors of the Exploded Ensemble here at CMU. And I want to welcome Annie up to the microphone to tell you a little bit about her piece, Elastic Chirping. Annie.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.